Mini Chapter 6, Jaymi conceives his game, the Platinum Raven. Jaymi paces around his study with growing restlessness. He has been resisting direct conflict with the Dreary Ones, but their launching the drone attack has kicked off the fight he never kicked off himself, and even brought it into his home, onto his property and into the heart of his life, provoking him on his very own terrace, on his own private promontory. How can he not respond? He must. He has no choice. Never before has he been so confronted with the new Bangdead culture's crass destructiveness. How dare they? He shies away from conducting any violent physical attack on them. It's just so very much not his style, and thank goodness for that. No, he will rise above such vulgar cloddishness and clunkiness as they have displayed. He'll reply by showing, not telling. He will respond to their destructiveness by creating something beautiful that didn't exist before. Their dull mediocrity will trigger such inventive joy and cheeky creativity from him, they won't even realize he's running rings around them. That burst of liberation he felt on the terrace a month ago, when he decided to take the helm himself in this industry, is now followed by the climb of a grim resolve in the face of what he knows, that, in addition to his continuing to design games, he must now cause their funding too, from development through production to marketing. So, how best can he respond to the Dreary Ones and their wretched game and their drone attack? Whichever direction he looks, in seeking the answer to this, only one aspect of the situation is clear yet, which is that he will have to pursue his activities on a war footing. Well, all right then, it's a war. A bit like life in general. Or like the wars in countless video games, funnily enough, but with any luck, a richer one than most of them. Like any truly original creation, his own game will carry, within the substance of its newness, an implicit destruction of the surrounding context where it lands, through showing up what was available to be refreshed in that context. But more specifically, within his game, he will externalise elements of his war footing itself, as personifications, as characters in the story world, as people whom he'll create. Each such character will develop in an organic way from its war-born embryo, via its body and senses and name, into a richly celled creature articulated through layer upon layer of accreted substance, from volition to agency to interaction, to an intelligence and mind of its own. He will then watch them being their own selves, running wild within the confines of his game world, and casting their multicoloured reflections on the outer world. Not a war game as such, but a game whose release will be, among other things, a war against war games. It's hard to say no, after all, to the prospect of a little conflict, provided the conflict is interesting. 10 minutes later, he steps out through his study doors onto the terrace and settles into an upright armchair with his computer on his lap, the evening panorama of LA twinkling ahead, and a limoncello on ice sitting on the terrace flagstones beside him. It happens that he already has a name for the game, the Platinum Raven, which came to him in a dream and will alight here on Electra Drive with ease. He's aware it is not ultimately a matter of importance for him to broadcast the intimate details of his own internal world in particular, but these details provide him with the truest way of dealing with the wider aspects of human existence that transcend individuals. What he's seeking is to communicate an authentic vision of human life and its possible meanings, aiming to use the language of his game to express what he's learned about all our presences here. He hopes to contribute to our rising above our individual points of view, to a point where we see the world, including ourselves, from above. This viewpoint will have its hazards, no doubt, such as the aloneness and alienation that attend any hunt for a god's eye view of us. But the hazards will be worth the hunt. In this spirit, he will distribute himself, he decides, among three in-game characters. One of these will be the eponymous Platinum Raven herself. He knows few details about her as yet, beyond the shining, platinum-haired grandeur of her seeming transcendence of everyday life. He feels he might kill, however, if this were necessary, to bag himself a ringside seat from which to watch her upcoming emergence into being. The second character will be a creature of his unrealizable desire to live life with an intensity flavored by self-destruction. He names this character Scorpio, after his own moon sign, a water sign, feminine and fixed, though as yet he knows even fewer details about Scorpio than about the Platinum Raven. Subsidiary to those two, there will then be a creature of his desire to wreak vengeance where deserved. Most games have several such characters after all, but the Platinum Raven will have the modest total of one, and Jaymi names him Amber. Amber will be off-centre, to say the least. But only the off-centre can supply a point of view that has any real interest, he reflects. The norm backs itself up without doing anything. Yes. Oh, and Amber will also be charming and lethal. So, there they are, it seems. His first three sexy beasts. Amber, the Platinum Raven, Scorpio. As yet, he knows little more about them than their names. But he catches furtive whispers as their silhouettes scurry past. Shadows on the gauze screens hung across his ballroom, flicking indistinct across the scrims and the curtains, red-lit and purple-lit behind where he sleeps, and their giggles and their shushing hidden just around the corner at the end of the corridor, far down there, though they've not dared peep around the plaster of the wall to find Jaymi with their eyes, so they don't know what he looks like, not quite yet.